Okay, let's proceed to the second part. As I've said, we're going to talk about the system. Can you say that word aloud? System.
System.
And lastly, we're going to talk about how to apply this in our respective churches. Okay? So now I want to walk you through the ladder of success. Okay, we call it, the system that we follow, the process is ladder of
success.
Okay, of course, when we talk about ladder of success, obviously, it's about the people that we are bringing to the Lord. So we are leading them, we are discipling them, so that they can attain to a certain point in their Christian life where they are also becoming fruitful for the Lord. Okay? So that's the point of ladder of success. And I want us to do this. I want us to observe this by the ministry of the Lord Jesus Christ himself. Okay? When we say ladder of success, okay, there are four steps. One, win, consolidate, disciple, and send. Amen? So win, consolidate, disciple, send. But actually, they say that you do not read it as win, consolidate. No, you read it as win, consolidate. You read it as one word. Okay? Win, consolidate. But because the emphasis here is please never win anyone without planning to consolidate him or her. Okay? And when you say disciple, it's not disciple send. No, disciple send. Hello? Yeah. It's not two words, it's one word. Because when you disciple someone, it should be with the clear intent that you want that person to also bear fruit for the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, you do not grow a tree just to make it grow. You grow it to make it bear fruit.
Yeah.
Amen? Amen? That's why you disciple in order to send. Okay? So, but I'm going to deal with each of these steps one by one. So in the case of the Lord Jesus Christ, this is very much observable. So of course, one of the most prominent disciples of the Lord Jesus is Peter, right? Right? So let's just take a look at how the Lord himself did, somehow did, you know, the ladder of success in the life of Peter. Okay? Let's start with winning Peter. Okay, in John chapter 1, verse 40 to 42, you will find this. Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, was one of the two who heard John and followed him. Okay, so take note of that. This was when the Lord Jesus was starting to do his ministry. And as he was recognized by John the Baptist in the earlier verses said, look, the Lamb of God that takes away the sins of the world. Remember?
Yes.
So, immediately some of the disciples of the Lord Jesus, of John the Baptist, decided to follow Jesus. And one of those was Andrew. Now, Andrew had a brother by the name of Simon. Okay? And so, what did Andrew do? In verse 41, he first found his own brother Simon and told him, we have found the Messiah. Okay, and which he means anointed one. Okay, what's next? Verse 42. And he brought Simon to Jesus. When Jesus saw him, he said, you are Simon, son of John. You will be called Kephas, which means rock. Okay, from weed, you are now a rock, because Simon means weed. Okay, so this was the time when Peter met the Lord Jesus Christ. This was the time when he was won to Jesus. Amen? Because sometimes when we take a look at the other gospel books, we tend to think that the very first time that the Lord Jesus met Peter was in was after he gone fishing, right? And then he immediately followed Jesus, immediately followed someone that he saw the first time. No, because he had a first encounter with the Lord Jesus. And that's right here. Okay, somebody brought him to the Lord and he had a personal encounter with Jesus. And because of that personal encounter, Now, immediately, something has changed inside of him. Amen?
Yeah.
Amen?
Yeah.
When the Lord Jesus declared, "You are Simon, now you will be called Peter," no? From Simon, which means red, now you will be called a rock or Petros or Kephas. Okay? So something has changed. Amen? We must believe that every time we win people, individual to the Lord, the person to the Lord, that person has experienced change in his life.
Yeah.
Amen?
Yeah.
So Jesus won Peter. Okay, come on, say that aloud again, win.
Win.
Okay, that's the first step. Okay, and of course, how do we win? Okay, there are many ways. I was talking about prayer of three yesterday. Then, there are many ways actually, evangelistic means. So, our intention is for the people to come to know the Lord, to know the Lord Jesus Christ. Okay, as I was emphasizing earlier, evangelize. But when we evangelize, it's not just to pray to receive Christ, it is for someone to repent and truly place his faith in the Lord Jesus. Okay? So, let us win people. Okay? Use your anniversary, think of special occasions in order to win people. Okay? Use your cell groups. Okay? Plan. It's very important to plan. In these plans, of course, it's very important to know how to connect to people, to pray for the people that we are planning, that we want to bring to the Lord, and then to actually share the gospel with them.
Yeah.
Amen?
Yeah.
So that's the first part, win. Okay? Now, was Peter consolidated? Actually, after Peter came to know the Lord Jesus, he did not stay with Jesus immediately. Right?
Yes, correct.
Hello?
Yeah.
Okay? Because sometimes when we share the gospel to individuals and then we just leave it at that, no, and without doing anything else, actually the tendency is that the people, after having heard the gospel, after placing their faith in the Lord Jesus, may still go back to their own lives, to their usual lives.
Yeah.
Right? So where did Jesus see Peter again? Okay, actually we're going backwards from John to Luke to Mark to Matthew, because we are following the footsteps. Okay, how he has become very fruitful upon the Lord. Okay, so now let's take a look at Luke chapter 5. What did Jesus do? He consolidated Peter. Come on, say that aloud. Consolidate.
Consolidate.
Okay. Luke 5 verse 1, as the crowd was pressing in on Jesus to hear God's word, he was standing by Lake Genesaret. Okay, let's continue reading. He saw two boats at the edge of the lake. The fishermen had left them and were washing their nets. So what's the picture? There were so many people crowding, wanting to be touched by Jesus, wanting to listen to the Lord. So what the Lord did was to somehow put up a stage for himself, no? But the stage was on water. Okay, to separate himself from the crowd. Okay, so the people were on the beach and he was on water, but of course he was on board a boat. Right? He borrowed a boat. And you guess whose boat it was? Come on. Whose boat? You know what? I really believe that the reason the Lord was in this lake during that time was not for this crowd. It was for Peter.
Amen.
Hello, because he wanted to do something. He's going to consolidate Peter. Okay? Peter already came to know the Lord Jesus Christ. But of course, he went back to his usual life. Okay? As a fisherman, so he has just done fishing during this time. Okay? So let's continue reading. Verse 3. He got into one of the boats which belonged to
Simon.
And asked him to put out a little from the land. Then he sat down and was teaching the crowds from the boat. Okay, verse 4. When he had finished speaking, he said to Simon, "Put out into deep water and let down your nets for a catch." We know that Peter had a trouble during this time. He knew that his mother-in-law is going to be mad at him. Why? Because he has no fish. No, that's why his mother-in-law was sick. Was he connected? Okay, that's the consequence when you put together verses without taking into consideration their context, you can invent any kind of teaching. Okay, you can invent your own religion, actually. Okay, okay. So he had no fish, right? But the Lord wanted to show Peter that he truly is powerful, that he truly is the Messiah. Amen? So he had no catch, but then he instructed him, put out into deep water and let down your nets for a catch. Of course, it was impractical during that time. Why? For the whole night, they were not able to catch anything, and now it's early, it's morning already. And of course, the fish are scattered, because the principle is that they fish at night because the fish gather when they see a light. So when they see the lamp of the fisherman, they gather there, okay? But now, of course, the sun is up, the fish are scattered. It's very much impossible. But anyway, Peter obeyed. And in verse 10, that's where you read the popular words, from now on, I will make you fishers. Hello? Okay? That may not be the exact word in Luke 5, but that's the point here, okay? So Jesus said, follow me. And I just took Peter, to James and John also. He called them to follow him. Follow me, and I will make you fishers of men. Brothers and sisters, it is not enough to just help people place their faith in the Lord Jesus. We should make them followers of the Lord. Amen? Amen? So Jesus warned Peter. What did he do next? He consolidated Peter. Okay, so that Peter would decide to spend his life following Jesus. That's the point of consolidation. Okay? We do not just share the gospel. We want to produce followers, serious followers of the Lord Jesus. Amen? Amen. And as you can notice here, when we are consolidating someone, actually, sometimes it's easier to share the gospel, right? To meet someone. Okay, Peter was just brought to the Lord Jesus. Okay, and he came to know the Lord. But you know what? The Lord Jesus took effort to consolidate Peter. Sometimes consolidation takes more effort than evangelism.
Yes.
Hello?
Yeah.
Okay? Sometimes you share the gospel because you just met this person in the church, or you just met this person somewhere, but you have to go to the person if you want that person to be preserved in the Lord.
Yeah.
Amen?
Yeah.
Okay? And that's the problem with so many churches. Okay? We think that we stop that when ever we have shared the gospel to an individual, the work is over. No, it's just the start.
Yeah.
Okay? We are just beginning. And we have to do the work of preserving the one who has come to know the Lord.
Yeah.
Okay? You know what? If you're just going to evaluate, why is it that some churches continue growing? Why? And why other churches are not growing when they are both doing evangelism? You know the secret? Consolidation. Okay? And you will see churches that are already big and still growing big. Why? You know their secret? They know how to consolidate. Okay? And even why is it that more people are getting saved in bigger churches when even the smaller churches are trying to bring people also? No? It is because I believe that in the if I'm going to think of it in the spiritual realm, maybe I'm thinking, no, that maybe when the Lord looks at the church and he says, okay, I'm going to birth someone into my family. Okay, what do you think? Will the Lord think, okay, that church has few members, so that they will increase. I'm going to give birth to this person in the church. I'm going to born again. I'm going to cause this person to be born again in this church because they're small. Will God think that way, do you think?
No, I don't.
Or will God think this way? Okay, I want this person to be born again. Okay, where is the warmest incubator? Where is the best church that can take care of this spiritual baby?
Amen. Yeah.
Hello?
Amen.
Because I believe that when God wants someone to be born again, He is going to look for a church that will be able to take care of that spiritual baby. That's why many big churches are still growing while they know how to take care of spiritual babies.
Yeah.
Amen? So it's not, sometimes it's not the effort of evangelism, sometimes it's the effort of consolidation.
Yeah.
Okay, so if we know how to preserve the spiritual babies, I believe God will entrust us with more.
Yeah.
Amen. Amen. Okay, so consolidate. So as you can see, the Lord Himself exerted effort in consolidating Peter. Okay. Of course, there are more that we can talk about this, and we're going to talk more about this in the tomorrow evening in the church of Pastor Tim. No? But suffice it to say now that we do not just win, we also consolidate. Okay. By the way, when we consolidate, that's why we have this, no? The life class. Okay. We were talking about this yesterday, right? So life class. This is our material for consolidation. And of course, the very important event in consolidation is what we call the encounter. Okay, so actually, in encounter, when a person goes to the encounter, there's really a huge percentage of that person immediately joining the church and continuing in the Lord. Okay, hello. Okay, so win and consolidate. But what's next? What's next? After Peter was consolidated, was he immediately part of the 12 of the Lord Jesus? Not really. Okay? There were more than 100 people following the Lord Jesus. Amen? Mixture, no? Of men and women. So in Mark chapter 3, please take a look at Mark chapter 3, verse 13. Then he went up on the mountain and summoned those he wanted. Those he wanted. And they came to him. Verse 14. Then he also appointed 12. He also named them apostles. Okay? To be with him. To send them out to preach. Verse 15. Okay? And to have authority to drive out demons. Okay? And verse 16. Okay? He appointed the 12. To Simon, he gave the name Peter. And of course, the following names, the 11. Okay, including Judas, of course. No? So as you can see, this was the time that Peter was truly discipled by the Lord. Okay, I mean, not truly discipled, but especially discipled by the Lord. Amen? So he was one, he was consolidated. No? Because you can share many people to the Lord, and then you consolidate them. No? And after you have consolidated these people, of course, you have to focus on few. Okay? Hello? You cannot focus on everyone. Right? If you have won 50 people to the Lord, will you be able to focus on them?
No.
Okay? Even if you are able to consolidate them all?
No, amen.
Okay? So, that's why we need to focus on few. Amen? So that's what we call discipleship. So here, we might use the word cell group. The Lord has started His own cell group of 12 people. Amen?
Yes.
Again, the word cell is biblical because Jesus said, go and sell your possessions. Okay? So, that's according to my own learning. Okay, so the Lord had grouped them, okay, into teams of 12. You know, in discipleship is very much important in our churches, okay? Because the intention of bringing people to the Lord is not just so they'll be saved, but so they'll continue, but not just to continue, okay? Because when we say they are continuing in the faith, the picture could be this, right? Continuing in the faith, yeah, but not growing.
Yeah.
So there must be discipleship. Okay, continuing in the faith must go like this. Okay, they're growing in the faith until they become fruitful for the Lord.
Amen.
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 Okay, so that is discipleship. Now, in here, in these few verses, we can find some principles, very important principles in discipleship. No, it says there he called those he wanted. Amen. These are the people that of course we can disciple, those that we want. No, what if I don't? He's not my type, pastor. No, Well, teach yourself to want Him. Because that's the person that God gave to you. Amen? Always remember, in discipleship, God will not give you finished products. Okay, God will give you raw materials. Okay? Was Peter already Christ-like when the Lord chose to make him part of the 12? No way! He's hot-headed. Right? Okay, he immediately jumps on water. And he even, what did he do when Jesus was being arrested? Right? Remember the sword? Okay, he was still hot. He was still hot-headed. Right? Okay, but the Lord discipled this person. Amen?
Yeah.
Please don't set so much standard on discipling people. I want people who are, fruitful. No? For you to be part of my 12, you must be fruitful. Okay? You must be Christ-like. You must be perfect. Come on. No? That's not the idea of discipleship. The idea of discipleship is finding someone whose life may not yet be in order, but you are going to help that person.
Amen?
Amen? Amen. Please, don't look for finished products. Okay? If you do not have finished products in your church, it's not their fault, it's your fault.
Amen?
Amen? Okay? Because we are discipling them. Hello? Okay? So he called those he wanted, so that they might be with him. Okay, so the principles here, want them, principle. That's number one, want them. Number two, with them, principle. Be with them. Spend time with your disciples, not just on Sunday. Anyway, they're listening to me every Sunday when I preach to them. No? Okay, that's not enough. Hello? Okay, anyway, when we meet in our centers, no, that's not, sometimes you have to spend time with them one-on-one. Amen?
Yeah.
So, discipleship is like that. Want them, with them. Number three, warrant them. Give them authority. Why? Why? The Lord Jesus, He saw that He might send them out to preach and give authority over demons. Amen? Empower them, meaning empower them. So, what are these principles? We want them, principle. With them, principle. Warrant them, principle. Amen?
Yeah.
Okay? So, disciple people. And as we all know, discipleship is lifelong. Amen?
Yes.
Okay? We call it intentional discipleship. Okay? Discipleship should be intentional. Okay? Of course, I believe that discipleship is happening in all churches. I guess all churches. Discipleship is happening. Why? Because every time the pastor preaches, that's discipleship. But that kind of discipleship is I would rather call incidental discipleship. Not intentional discipleship. And we know the difference, right? Like when you go see a doctor and the doctor tells you, your cholesterol and sugar, your blood sugar is high, so you've got to put out some sweat, right? Right? Okay, and you say, yes doc, I'm gonna do that, no? And then you went home, and what you did was then you iron clothes, right? You wash your clothes. Of course, you can get sweaty, right? And then you go back to the doctor, and you have this laboratory exam again. They go, no change, no. Are you putting out sweat? No. Yes, doc. What did you do? No. I iron clothes. I cook our meals. Okay. Yeah, but those kind of sweat was incidental. Hello, when the doctor says, okay, come on, get sweaty. No, it means you exercise.
Yeah.
When you exercise, that's intentional.
Yeah.
Amen?
Yeah.
So in the church, when a person comes to church, he is being incidentally discipled simply because he's listening to preaching. But when you want intentional discipleship, it should be we are spending time with that individual.
Yeah.
Amen? So our discipleship here is not just it naturally happens. So something that we do on purpose.
Yeah.
Amen?
Yeah.
Okay? So disciple. Okay. And of course, send. Come on, say that aloud. Send.
Yeah.
Okay? Of course, in in, I guess, Matthew 9, in Matthew 11, or Matthew 10, the Lord also sent Peter, no, in the rest of the 12, 2x2. No, but the verse that I want us to look at is this, no? When the Lord, before the Lord Jesus came back to heaven, or went back to heaven, okay, we're familiar with this. The Lord Jesus said, "Go and make disciples of all nations." To whom was Jesus talking to? Come on. Of course, he was talking to the 12. And obviously, the 12 includes Peter. No, this time 11. No? He was talking to the 11, and that includes Peter. Right? And he was sending them. Okay? And what was the instruction? Go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the Father, Son, the Holy Spirit, and teach them to obey everything I have commanded you. Okay? So that's discipleship. You send someone, you disciple him, so that he can also disciple others.
Yeah.
Hello?
Yes.
Okay? So you make disciple of that person so that he can also do disciple making. Amen?
Amen.
Okay? So that's why teach them to obey everything I have commanded you. I emphasize this during our first evening. Remember, no, that discipleship is for everyone. Why? Simply because of this verse. Every disciple should be taught to obey all of the commands of Jesus. And obviously, all of the commands of Jesus includes go and make disciples. So if I am a disciple, even if I am not a pastor, even if I am a new believer, as long as I am a disciple, I am taught to obey the command. I should be taught to obey the command. And one of those commands is go and make disciples. That's why we say send. Okay? So when?
Consolidate.
Disciple. Send. Brothers and sisters. Okay? The Lord Jesus himself did it on Peter. Okay? And do you believe that you can produce Peters in your ministry?
Amen.
If Jesus won someone, why wouldn't I? If Jesus consolidated, why wouldn't I? Okay? If Jesus discipled and sent, why wouldn't I? Hello? Okay? Do you believe that you can produce great disciples? Come on, you have to believe that. Huh?
Yes.
Do you believe that?
Amen.
Okay? So again, let's close this in prayer. Let's pray. Lord, we receive this in our hearts. We believe, Lord, that you are going to use us. I pray for that special anointing to win people, to consolidate people, to disciple people, and to send people.
Yes.
Use us, Lord. Use us in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Okay? I will continue on. Pastor, for our third session, is that okay with you?
Yes.
Okay, aren't you tired? Okay, so it's okay with you, huh? Okay, so let's begin with our third part. Okay, you know, I'm rushing because it's daily saving time, so. Okay, I want to save time. Okay. For now, this is what we can do, okay, for the last 3 days. And I hope our sessions the past 3 days have helped a lot. So right now, I want us to think or talk about how to actually do it in our respective churches. So what's the step that I'm going to take, Pastor? Okay, so remember in our first evening, I talked about what is G12, right? And of course, the following days, we talk about this. The biblical principles, the heart of this, the system, okay? And now, just few steps, practical steps that we can do if you believe the Lord is leading you to do this. Again, we are not saying that G12 is the only one that the Lord is using. What we are saying is that the Lord uses many things, and G12 is one of those. G12 is one, I would say one of the biggest instruments of the Lord. Okay? Hello? No?
Yes.
So it's very important that we, if we want to serve the Lord, we also use a strategy. Amen?
Yes.
Hello, amen? Yes. It's like if you want to go somewhere, you need to have a vehicle. Okay, so consider G12 as a vehicle. Okay, I want to be there. Yeah, I can walk if I want to, No, but how long will it take me? So if I don't have a vehicle, it's on my own, no? So anything goes, I just walk. Or if I take a bicycle, yeah, it's also okay, no? If I take a car, yeah, it depends on the car again. Right?
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Okay, so G12 is just like that, no? We want to do something for the Lord, so let's have a vehicle on how to do it. Amen?
Yes.
Okay, so how to start G12 in your church? This won't be long, really. Then we're going to ask the Lord for His blessings upon our church, no? Later on. Amen?
Yes.
Amen? And us as individuals. Okay, number one is form new values. Form new values. Because really, ministry is value formation. Amen. Even if you're not doing G12, you're forming the values of the people. Okay?
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Like, if they are used to doing things that are, we know, are evil in the sight of God, of course we form their values so that they're going to stop or they're going to quit whatever evil it is. Right?
Yeah.
Amen. Amen? So even like going to church, of course there's something that we have formed in our people. That's why now they are regularly attending our church.
Mm.
Amen? Offering. Of course, that's value formation. Before, they do not do that, but now it has become their value. But now when we say form new values, okay, we are thinking of course, the values that are important for an individual to grow and to bear fruit for the Lord. Amen?
Yeah.
So like, remember, I talk about four basic lifestyles. So it should become their value to do their daily devotions, commune with the Lord. Okay, so talk about that. You know what? Pastors, the secret, if you want your people to truly be with you in what the Lord wants you to do, so that they can help you, teach them to listen to the Lord. Why? Because when you are doing the work of the Lord, God will also tell them to do the work with you through their personal time with God. That's why we have this one disciple, now she's a very active and fruitful one of the primary 12 of my wife. No? Before, somehow she was resistant, no? reluctant to do it. But the good thing with her is that she's listening to the Lord. She does her devotion. No, and because she's listening to the Lord, it was God Himself who spoke to her through particularly in her communion with the Lord. So her heart has changed, and now she's helping us. Okay,
yeah.
So if we believe that this is what the Lord wants us to do, don't worry about it. The Lord will speak to your people.
Amen.
Okay, but if they do not open their Bibles, if you do not teach them to listen to the Lord, no, how can they hear the instruction of the Lord?
Yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
So that's why we teach people to commune with God. No? That's one of the values. We teach people the importance of being discipled. Okay, this is very important that we go through intentional discipleship.
Yeah.
We teach people the importance of winning. Of winning the loss to Jesus Christ, no? These are values, okay? And actually, please take note that we are not teaching something that is new. Again, we are emphasizing the basics.
Yeah.
Amen?
Yeah.
That's why they say that if you want to do, if you want to follow what God wants you to do in your church, there are three things that we need to do. Number one is to unlearn, relearn, and learn. Okay, what do we unlearn? There may be some habits that we that somehow has become acceptable to us. Then we have to unlearn those.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Amen.
Yeah.
Okay. So what are these? Like for instance, my value is that I just go to church. What was that important? So that I complete my attendance every Sunday. No. And that's enough for them. They have to unlearn that. Amen?
Yeah.
Okay? The word of God is just an option. We have to unlearn that. Hello?
Yeah.
Okay? Or other bad habits. What do we relearn? Relearn? Okay? Actually, more on relearning. Right?
Yeah.
Doing devotions, is that a G12 thing? No. Hello?
Yeah.
First, it's in the Bible. And in the history of Christianity, you will see people of God spending time with God. Amen? Even in other ministries, that's an emphasis. It's just that we have to relearn it. Because somehow many believers or many churches have forgotten to put emphasis on this. Amen?
Yeah.
So we learn. And then learn. What do we learn? Yeah, the things that we are not used to. Like, I don't know how to share the gospel yet. I don't know how to lead cell groups. I don't know how to disciple. Then that's why we have our training.
Yeah.
Hello?
Yeah.
So unlearn, relearn, and
learn.
No? So form new values. Okay. Next is plant the vision. He plant the vision in their hearts. What we are doing here is vision casting. Okay, that's what we also need to do that in our churches. We should help our people widen their perspective. Know that this is not just about us. This is not just about them. God is calling us to also help others get to know the Lord Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Have a big vision. Of course, the vision must. Start where? Come on. Where should it start? Should it start from? Where should it start? In the pastor's life. In the pastor's heart.
Yeah.
Amen. Okay? And then we pass it on to our people. No? We can pastor, we can lead the church without vision. Okay? We can be in the maintenance mode. We can do that. No? But is that what God wants us to do? I don't think so. Okay,
yeah.
So have a vision, and then give this vision, implant this vision to the lives of your people. Amen?
Yeah.
The vision, by the way, is not just about church growth. Of course, it's about building the kingdom of the Lord.
Amen.
Okay?
Yeah.
And the effect would be national transformation.
Amen?
Amen?
Yeah.
Okay, so plant the vision. Have prototype sales. Okay? Have prototype sales. Itching? No?
Yeah.
The long answer?
Yeah.
Okay, so I'll say this in 30 seconds. Long answer. Okay. So when you say prototype sales, this will be your model cell. That's why we are talking about DNA. Okay, every cell, like in the body of a certain person, right? Okay, there must be single DNA, right? So, okay, we're going to have this cell group. And this cell group must be the DNA of all the other coming or rising cell groups.
Amen?
Amen?
Yeah.
So the best way to do it is for the pastor to start a cell group. Okay? For the men. And for the women to have a cell group being led by the pastor's wife. Okay? So that will be the prototype cell. Because you know, if the mother cell is, of course, defective, unhealthy, what do you expect of the succeeding cells? Hello? So the model cell must come from the pastor and the pastor's wife. So what you can do, as I was saying last night, is that we can form small groups in our church. Okay? But before doing that, it's best that the pastor meet with the prospective leaders. Like for instance, let me give you this picture. I have a congregation, for instance, of 50 people, and I want to start doing cell group. So what do we do? Okay, I'm going to choose, because we have 50 people, then we can divide them into 10 groups. So I'm going to need 10 leaders, right? Let's just say, okay, 5 men and 5 women. Okay, so the men will be met by the pastor prior to opening these cell groups. Okay, meet with them, teach them. Okay, this is how we are going to do it. No, the same thing with the women. No, and after that preparation, after that training, these leaders who can now lead small groups, then you can practice doing cell group. Okay, as I've said, on a Sunday service, okay, after the preaching, okay, brothers and sisters, can we group ourselves into 5? Okay, I have written here, you can prepare the grouping. Okay, under so-and-so will be these people, these five people, okay? And under this, under sister, okay? You will please join her, these individuals, okay? Okay, and then from there, you can they can discuss the word of God that you have just preached. More on application. Amen.
Amen.
Okay, you can do that for a month or two. And then next is okay, we have been doing this. How about doing it not inside the church and not on a Sunday, but outside? Okay. Of course, before doing that, you should continually. Be training your leaders so that they know what to do when they go outside already.
Yeah.
Amen?
Yeah.
So that's prototype cell group. Okay? So like for instance, I'm going to meet with the leaders that I'm training every Tuesday. Okay? Can we agree that you meet on, that everyone, every group meet on the following days, like Wednesday to Friday? Yeah. Right? Okay, so they can agree. Now, if someone will not be able to because of their schedule, then we just have to understand that. Okay, so what's important is that we are helping our people to be part of a group wherein they can grow more in their faith. Amen.
Amen.
By the way, no? As we talk about this, some of you might be thinking of time, busy. Hello. Okay, and some even think that, oh, Pastor, it's easy in the Philippines because you know the Philippines is a third world country, it's a poor country. So now you are now giving credit to our poverty. Hello. So the church is growing because Philippines is poor. No. Of course, the credit should be to the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Amen. It's the work of the Holy Spirit. Besides, okay. Let me just answer that concern. Okay. Is it true that it's easier for us?
No.
Think of this. The traffic is so heavy in Manila. Okay. So think of this. If my work is 8 to 5, for instance, I am one of the young professionals in the church, and I am a cell leader or a cell member. You know what? If I am going to work on the central business district of Metro Manila, that will take me about 2 hours.
Whoa.
By bus or by even sometimes even by train, because before you reach the train, you have to still ride the bus. Okay, and you have to get down the train and take another ride. Okay, so let's say 2 hours. So if my work starts at 8 a.m.,
yeah.
Then I have to wake up at about 5.
Yeah.
Hello?
Yes.
6 to 8, I'm going to spend for my travel time. Okay? Going back home?
Yeah.
Come on. That would be another two hours.
2 hours.
Sometimes more. Okay? So 2 hours. 5, so 6, and 7. Sometimes they get home by 8 p.m. But these people still manage to lead their cell groups or join their cell groups.
Yeah.
Come on. I tell this in many other countries. I say this in Japan. Here in Japan, you have very efficient transportation. Okay? When you say it's 30 minutes, it's really 30 minutes. In the Philippines, when you say it's 30 minutes time, depends on the traffic. Yeah, truly, the central business district of my place, you can reach it, I guess, in 30 minutes. But 30 minutes, you cannot really do that. It will be at least 2 hours. Hello, you have efficient transportation here. Amen.
Yeah.
Hello, amen.
Amen.
Okay, and actually, the life condition of people in first world countries is very much better than the situation of our people. So it must be easier for you.
Amen.
Okay? It's not true that it's easier for poorer countries. Hello. It's about the fire of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
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 Amen. Okay? So have prototype cells. Number 4, do the process. Okay? Again, you can start the process. What's the process again? Win, consolidate, disciple, send. But in this case, actually, win Of course, I want you to understand that in every step of win, consolidate, disciple, send, there are things that we do. Okay? Win, of course, means we share the gospel, right? Consolidate means going through this, okay, life class, and this one, and bringing the person to the cell group. That's consolidation. Okay? And even starting up your new life booklet, remember, now we share with them individually. Okay? Discipleship is in, when you say win, consolidate, this one, disciple, they attend cell groups, and we have our leadership training school of leaders like this one. Okay? So school of leaders, you see, we have complete materials, and you do not have to spend time writing new materials or thinking of new lessons. You can just apply them. Okay? As we say, we don't have to reinvent the wheel. Okay? Oh, my writing is much better than this one. No? I'll just write first. No? Okay? You consume all your time thinking of new materials, and then nothing happened. I'm saying this because I did that. Okay? When I heard of G12, and when I learned it, when I learned a little, I started writing my own material. Okay? So and it didn't work, by the way. So, okay, do the process. Okay, the process that we're talking about is, again, a new believer up to becoming a cell leader. But when I say do the process here, it's not about the new believers yet. Do it among your people.
Yes.
Amen?
Amen?
Why is that? Because they will not value anything that they themselves have not gone through, have not experienced. Why would they encourage people to go through the encounter if they themselves did not have that encounter experience?
Yeah.
Amen?
Yeah.
Okay? So that's why it's important that the pastor, okay, the leaders, the members go through the process. Again, in the Philippines, we pastors, even bishops with hundreds of churches under them, no, even with 1,000 churches, no, actually went through the process. So don't say that, hey, I'm already 5 years in this church. I know all of that. No, come on, it's not about us knowing all of this. It's about us experiencing this. Mm-hmm. And when you experience this, you know that this will do something greater in your life.
Mm-hmm.
Encounter maybe, you may know the subject. Yeah, I know that Jesus died for me. Yeah, I know the Lord sets me free. Okay, yeah, I know the Holy Spirit. Yeah, we know. But for those who have encountered this, even they are years in the faith already, it is still a great blessing to them, including myself. Mm-hmm. My wife, no, and many other pastors and bishops in the Philippines. After going through an encounter, it was like they were new believers. Okay? Pastors were born again. Amen? So we need that. Who wants to be born again? Okay? So let's do the process. Amen? Life class, and then go through the school of leaders. So they'll be trained, so they know how to handle it. Amen. Okay, set up structure. What's the structure again? Okay, it's like the prototype, but the structure of cell group. Okay, so you can begin by, okay, I start with these few people. Again, if you do not have your 12 yet, it's okay.
Yeah.
Hello?
Yeah.
Because that's a problem with others. Right? As I said, but G12 is not applicable for us. Why? Because we only have 11 members. No. Even if you have 3, you can do it. Did Jesus start with 12?
No.
Come on. He just called them, won them one by one. Mm. And consolidated them one by one. Mm. Amen?
Yeah.
Okay? So, with what you start with what you have. Okay? The discipleship structure. Okay, the training structure, you can also set it up. Okay, appoint a director, no? Life class, director, school of leaders, director, no? And appoint some teachers. Okay? But of course, before we do that, we have to go through the encounter first. Okay? So, but these are the things that we can do more on the equipping and the cell group. And you know what? The best, truly, the best person who can lead the equipping track, the training, I think it's the pastor's wife. Or someone who is very systematic. Amen? Because sometimes we pastors are, you know, the idea persons, no? We have the big picture, no? And sometimes we forget the details. That's why I'm blessed with my wife, no? She minds the details. Okay? Amen? Okay? So think of that, no? You don't have to immediately follow the structures of big churches. No, it's not like that, you know? Just set up the initial structure, the one that you need. Amen? Yeah. Structure of discipleship, okay, cell group, men, cell group, women. Okay, we need to have a training. Okay, so we do this one. Amen? Okay? And of course, get mentoring. Lastly, get mentoring. Okay? So you know what? It's very important that we are being coached. Amen? Hello? Like as they say, Michael Jordan is a great player, but of course without his coach, right, he may not have been able to really give such output, you know, in his games, right?
Yeah.
Right? Stephen Curry, yeah, but without Steve Kerr, hello?
Yeah.
Manny Pacquiao, but without Fred Rhodes, di ba? Without Coach Rhodes, Cap Rhodes. Right? Hello? So we need coaches. Amen? Okay, so, you know what? Why is it working really well in the Philippines? This is our secret. Regular mentoring. Okay? And you know what? Filipinos are being, of course, to God be the glory, huh? Filipinos are being sent by the Lord in many areas, in many nations of the world, to teach this vision. Okay? We have regular mentoring in Russia. Okay? Of course, Filipinos even come to Africa. No? We have, actually, this coming November, we're going to, again, have intensive training for pastors. No, in Virginia, USA. So I'm going there in the US. I'm going to the US in this November, and then from the United States, we're going down to Japan, no, before I proceed home. No, so 3 days in the US, maybe another 2 days of training, or 3 days of ministering again in Japan. So then we spend some time eating ramen, no? So we do that. We are helping many nations. Okay. Sometimes, of course, many Filipino churches also, but in many nations like in Russian churches. Okay, in America, join, no, Filipino and other nationalities, white churches. Okay. In Dubai, we also do this. We are helping churches there, no. By the way, I myself, I do not go to Russia yet, it's Bishop Oriel, no? And many other countries, we have been doing this. Now we are doing mentoring. Why? Because people need to be coached.
Yeah.
Okay? As you can see, maybe these past 3 days, we have been able to share quite a lot already, no? Yeah. But you know, as we do the vision again, the issue here really is not more on the what's, right? It's really more on the spirit of the vision. No? And even if you already know something, if you heard it today, but you are not yet doing it, it doesn't mean much to you. But when you are doing it and you hear it again, oh, okay, I see. That's how it works, right? They say, since you are not yet consolidating now, so even if I talk about consolidation, no, you understand it, but it may not mean much. But the moment you are doing consolidation, oh, that's it, right? Cell group, oh, that's it. Okay, that's why we do continuous mentoring. Mm-hmm. So in our churches, in our gatherings, this is what we do. Pastor Tim has observed this when he went to our church. We gather the pastors first, no, and more on pastoral talk, no, and then in the evening we gather the leaders, the members, so they join. Why? It is not enough to set the pastor on fire or to help the pastor, no, because even if the pastor is on fire, if the people are not, the pastor will be alone. Yeah. Amen. Yeah. Amen. Yeah. Okay. So that's why if the pastor is being encouraged or fed or being fired up, it should happen to the members also. Okay. Or of course, it is not also right to just send your member. I just send my member, and then the pastor will not come. No. Yeah, so the members become fired up, and the pastor, okay? So, although, of course, it's easier for pastor to be fired up. Amen?
Amen.
Hopefully. Hello, amen. Amen? Okay, so we need regular mentoring. Of course, I thank Pastor Tim, I really appreciate Pastor Tim. It's the reason why we are here, me and my wife are here, and it's the reason why many of you are here, because of your friendship with him, because of your connection, no? So I thank the Lord. So I think we're just going to talk about it with Pastor Kim, no, as to what we are going to do next. Amen.
Yes.
Do you think that this is something that should be followed up?
Amen.
Hello, hello. No.
Yes.
Do you think that we can do this regularly? Hello?
Yes.
Okay, our next schedule is next Monday. Okay, so Pastor Tim, let's just talk about this. So what, of course, I also want you to get feedback, no, to have the pulse here, no, so what's in the heart of the people, no? Because of course, we are not trying to enforce it to anyone. Okay,
yeah.
Only if you just want it.
Yeah.
Amen?
Amen?
Amen. Amen. So these are the simple steps that we can do for now. Okay? And as we go on, we will understand it much better. And as you, I think my final word to you is this. No? It, of course, involves effort.
Yeah.
Okay? Especially at the beginning. Right?
Yes.
But for me, if you're just going to ask me, I would rather exert effort now and then see the results later, rather than not doing anything or just maintaining what I am used to do and not seeing any result.
Amen.
Okay, I think I'd rather exert effort. I would rather transition now so that eventually I'll see a different result rather than maintain what I do. And expect nothing.
Yeah.
Nothing new.
Mm-hmm.
Hello?
Yes.
Okay? So, let's pray about this. And let's ask the Lord, truly, of course, prayer is important, but at the same time, no, our efforts, our words are important. Amen?
Amen?
Salvation is by faith alone. Truly. But church growth, national transformation, kingdom building is by faith and works.
Amen.
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 Okay, so can we pray for you now? Can we pray for you? Maybe can I call my wife so we can pray for you? And can we pray for individuals? I think we still have some time. Amen. That should be 8:46, Pastor Jenny, right? 8:46. Okay. So yeah. My wife will pray for the women, and then I think we can just pray as a group, no? Okay, and then I'll also pray for the men, no? Of course, believing that God is going to do something.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
Do we want increased anointing? Do we want revival in our churches?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay, so can we all rise up? Can we all rise up? Just worship the Lord. Just worship God. Just thank the Lord for our calling. Just thank the Lord for what is time.